Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another, or say to each other, Know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and remember their sin no more. Here ends the first
prayer. How did you celebrate? God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Though its waters rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble with its tumult,
there is a river which streams and lands the city of God, a holy habitation of
God. God is in the midst of the city, it shall not be shaken. God shall help it at the break of day.
The nations rage and the kingdoms shake. God speaks and the earth melts away.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
The Lord, what desolations God has brought us on the earth.
Behold the one who makes war to cease in all the world, who breaks the bow and shatters the spear and burns the shields with fire.
Be still then, and know that I am God, and I will be exalted among nations, and I will be exalted in your earth.
The Lord of the hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed, and is attested by the law and the prophets. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are now justified by his grace as a gift, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement for his blood, effective through faith. He did this to show his righteousness, because of his divine forbearance, he had passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous, and that he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? By that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law. Here ends the second reading.
Hymn number 369.
Thank you.
Esposito and Terry are landlords. And the purpose of the meeting was to talk about what is our rent going to be for the coming year for this building and for the convent. At the beginning of the meeting, Father Esposito said words to these effect, "We are glad you are here because we are all on the same team. We're all engaged in the same work." Do you remember, Donald, exactly what his words were? But that was the gist of it. Today is Reformation Sunday, when we think about Martin Luther and the other reformers of the 1500s. And there were certainly times when a Catholic priest and a Lutheran pastor would not have exchanged those kinds of greetings. There were times when we were literally at war with one another. But fortunately, those days are far in the past. And although we certainly don't agree anymore, don't agree on everything, we at least recognize that in the greater scheme of things, we are all on the same team, the team of Jesus Christ. And that what is common for us is far more important than what is different for us. So with that spirit, we move into Reformation Sunday. And there are three things that we will do. First, we will look at the timeline I gave you. I've made that more difficult for you by turning out the lights, but having the lights out may help when we come to see the slides, and feel free to move around if you want to come closer. And then at the end, I will read something written by Martin Luther for an example of what he himself wrote. Now, Martin Luther, after whom we take our name, no, we are not named after a civil rights leader of the 1960s, as probably 53% of the people out there would think. We are named after Martin Luther of the 1500s of Germany. And the timeline will tell you that he was born in the year 1483 in a place in Germany called Eisleben. It is ironic. He was born in Eisleben, and if you jump to the end of the list, he died in Eisleben in 1546. He hardly ever lived in Eisleben. Even after he was born, his family soon moved from there, so it's somewhat ironic that he's born and died in the same place, even though he hardly was ever there. He entered the university in Erfurt, Germany, and was going to be a lawyer, his father's wish for him. But he had an experience that led him to want to become a monk, a priest. And so he gives up the studying of law in 1505 and enters a monastery. And there he lives with other people who are also monks. 1507, he is ordained a priest. In 1511, he was transferred to the monastery in a place called Wittenberg. And Wittenberg had a university. Luther had been there for a short time before, but now he's being transferred there in 1511. And he'll stay there for most of the rest of his life, with a couple notable exceptions. He earns his doctorate. He joins the faculty at the university in Wittenberg. 1517, he criticized the sale of indulgences, papers that were sold by the Catholic Church that claimed to show that the person in whose name the paper was issued was free from purgatory, whether that person was alive and buying the certificate, or if that person was already dead and it was being bought for, paid for by one of their relatives or descendants. Luther felt that this sale of indulgences was wrong, and he posted 95 ideas to talk about, ideas that were largely critical of indulgences, posting them on the church door of the Castle Church in Wittenberg. This caused quite a stir, challenged a major income flow for the church. And by church, I mean, of course, the Catholic Church in Germany at that time. That was the only church there was. True also for France, England, Spain, Western Europe in general. Luther was summoned before the emperor at the Diet or Council of Worms, a city in Western Germany. They heard him speak, condemned him. He went into hiding in a place called the Wartburg. His local ruler protected him, and that's what kept him from being executed. During his time in hiding, he began translating the New Testament into German. And in 1522, returns to Wittenberg, and the New Testament only is published at this point. Several years later, he marries a former nun named Catherine von Bora, and 1526, he becomes the father of a son named Hans, the first of six children. Some of them will die as one very shortly after birth, one is a teenager, young teen, some of them live to adulthood. By this point, he supports the organization of a separate church, a Lutheran church in Saxony, that part of Germany where he lived. Throughout this entire period, he is writing many, many things. And in 1529, he publishes a small catechism for use in training children and adults as well. And he also writes a large catechism, from which I will read. His father died in 1530, his mother 1531. By 1534, he could publish the entire Bible in German and continue making revisions to it until 1545. He died in Eisleben, Germany, February 18, 1546. He had gone there to try to resolve a dispute among a couple people, and while he was there, he took ill and died, but he was brought back to the Castle Church in Wittenberg and is buried there inside the church, which strikes some of us as odd. But even if you go to some churches in Philadelphia from the 1700s, you will find burials inside the church. And certainly it was not unusual back in 1546 in Germany. So that's the timeline. We will now go to the slides. It was known during Luther's lifetime that he was famous and would be famous. There was a painter in the town of Wittenberg who painted him, his wife, and his parents, knowing that he was going to be remembered as someone important. So we do have Pope pictures of him, paintings. Here he is later in life. Here he is as he was dressed when he was in hiding for that year, pretending to be a knight. This is his mother. And this is father. His father was in the mining business and wanted his son, as I said, to go to be a lawyer, considered to be a more important profession. And this is Luther's wife. This is the church in Eisleben where he was baptized. This is the main square in Erfurt. Erfurt, Germany, where he went first to the university and then went into a monastery. And this is the gate into the monastery where he had this as his room. This is the church in the monastery looking towards the back, and this is the place where he became a monk, where he went through the ceremony to become a monk. He moves to Wittenberg, as I said. This is the building at the east end of town where the monks live. This was the university where he taught. The university ended, and that building isn't there. But this one is, as well as the one that you see behind it. And that is the building where he went, where the monks were living. After Lutherans did away with monasteries and convents, monks and nuns, it was given to Luther for his use. Obviously, it's a larger building than one person needs, and so he had students living in the building as well. While he was teaching at the university, he also worked in the town church. And there you see simply the towers of the church. It's not a church you can get a good picture of because there are houses all around it. But that would be the two towers of the church. That is a painting inside the church. It was not there when Luther was the pastor, but it is from the 1500s, and it shows Luther and some of the people who worked with him and who worshiped in the church. It shows the sacraments, baptism, and communion, the power of the keys, or forgiveness, and preaching. And here is a picture of a baptism. There's more of the interior of the church after considerable renovation. It would not have looked like that when Luther preached there. And here is a painting from that center altarpiece that is to show Luther preaching. And so this is Luther, another painting of him by people who would have known what he looked like. He is pointing to Christ crucified, which is what he said preaching is supposed to hold up, the death of Christ and its significance for us. And over here are people listening to him preach, and they're able to identify pretty well all the people in the painting because they were people of that time. This is the town hall in the middle of Wittenberg, a new building when he was there. And now there is a statue of him in front of the town hall. At the western end, the opposite end of the town, compared to where Luther lived, was the castle. This is where his local ruler would have lived, and it was a fortification, as well as a place to live, because if you look at that tower, you can see it's a rather sturdy tower, no big windows, as you would think a fortification would not want to have large windows. Close to that castle, adjacent to it, is the church where Luther nailed the 95 Theses. And that is the door opening where the door would have been. But the original wooden door is long gone. What is there now is a bronze door, and if you go up close enough to it, you could read the 95 Theses. The entire document is put there in bronze to commemorate this is where Luther nailed the 95 Theses. This is an indulgence chest. You see what looks like a funnel at the top. That's where you put your money in, and then it goes into the chest. The idea was you put your money in there, and then from a priest you got this piece of paper that said you will leave purgatory. Here's the interior of the castle church, and this is where Luther is buried. That's the monument or marker in the church to say where he's buried. If you go back to Eisleben, you will see this room, and they'll tell you, here is where Luther died. Right town, probably the wrong building. It was identified on the basis of records. Who owned the building? Well, after that, they discovered this person owned another building as well, and the other building is more likely the one where Luther died. But if you want to go see a bed, you can see this one, and they'll tell you he died there. This is the Wartburg Castle, where he went into hiding. And that's the end. I thought there was one more, but I guess not. So anyway, Luther wrote many, many things, including this large catechism. Now, the small catechism, how many of you were confirmed in a Lutheran church? Tell me, what are the topics covered in the small catechism? Ten Commandments,
Lord's Prayer,
Apostles' Creed, Baptism, and Communion. The same things are covered in the large catechism. And obviously in a large catechism, he has more space to write about things. So here's what he writes about concerning the first commandment, you shall have no other gods before me. That is, you shall regard me alone as your God. What does this mean? And how is it to be understood? What is it to have a God? What is God? Answer. And understand, Luther is writing the question and then writing the answer. A God is that to which we look for all good, and in which we find refuge in every time of need. To have a God is nothing else than to trust and believe him with our whole hearts. As I have often said, the trust and faith of the heart alone makes both God and an idol. If your faith and trust are right, then your God is the true God. On the other hand, if your trust is false and wrong, then you have not the true God. For these two belong together, faith and God. That to which your heart clings and entrusts itself is, I say, really your God. The purpose of this commandment, therefore, is to require true faith and confidence of the heart. And these fly straight to the one true God and cling to him alone. The meaning is, see to it that you let me alone be your God and never seek another. In other words, whatever good thing you lack, look to me for it and seek it from me. And whenever you suffer misfortune and distress, come and cling to me. I am the one who will satisfy you and help you out of every need. Only let your heart cling to no one else. This I must explain a little more plainly, so that it may be understood and remembered, by citing some common examples of failure to observe this commandment. Many a person thinks he has God and everything he needs when he has money and property. In them he trusts, and of them he boasts so stubbornly and securely that he cares for no one. Surely such a man also has a God, Mammon by name, that is money and possessions, on which he fixes his whole heart. It is the most common idol on earth. He who has money and property feels secure, happy, fearless, as if he were sitting in the midst of paradise. On the other hand, he who has nothing doubts and despairs, as if he never heard of God. Very few there are who are cheerful, who do not fret and complain, if they do not have mammon. The desire for wealth clings and cleaves to our nature all the way to the grave. So too, if anyone boasts of great learning, wisdom, power, prestige, family, and honor, and trusts in them, he also has a God, but not the one true God. Notice again how presumptuous, secure, and proud people become because of such possessions, and how despondent when they lack them or are deprived of them. Therefore, I repeat, to have a God properly means to have something in which the heart trusts completely. And of course, in his writings, in his work, what Luther wanted people to trust in, the true God, and what God did for us on the cross, as you saw in the picture, Luther pointing to Jesus Christ crucified as our hope and our God. Thank you very much. Now, since we already had the hymn, but I need time to take things down, we will now sing the last hymn, 514.
Thank you.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In gratitude and humility, let us join together in prayer on behalf of all of God's creation. God, our fortress, we pray for the church. Write your law of love on the hearts of your people, that we remain steadfast in our witness to your grace. Hear us, O God. God, our liberator, we pray for your earth. Bring new life to overused land and contaminated rivers. Reform and reorient our relationship with the environment, that we carefully care for all of your creation. Hear us, O God. God, our refuge and strength, we pray for the nations. Where they are in an uproar, bring wise leadership and comfort for those in distress. Make wars to cease and peace to enter every land. Hear us, O God. God, our very present help in trouble, we pray for those in need. Show mercy to refugees and all fleeing from danger. Shelter any without homes. Calm all who are facing illness, surgery, or a new diagnosis. And we pray for those we know who are sick and recovering, for example, from operations, including Ron and Marianne and others we name in our hearts. Hear us, O God. God, our Redeemer, we pray for our congregation. Bless all who are preparing for baptism or affirmation of baptism. Open their hearts to your Holy Spirit. Teach them your word and give them courage to proclaim their faith. Hear us, O God. God, our stronghold, we give thanks for those who have gone before us in faith, especially Martin Luther and all reformers. Renew and reform us as we strive to continue in your word. Hear us, O God. With grateful hearts, we commend our spoken and silent prayers to you, O God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray as our Lord taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. I had a brief consultation with Jean Hinderleiter, and it seems that, again, tomorrow there would be at most half of the Bible study group, so we will not have Bible study again because there are too many away or recovered. So not tomorrow.
Hopefully, I don't know if they'll be back tomorrow, but I know they're away today.
Yes, and we know Ron is away. So, but my class will meet now, and we will be going out eventually for lunch. And did you get that message? Okay. And again, I'd like just very briefly to ask a question of the church council. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You sang everything you needed to sing. You're free to go.
Thanks be to God.